Head over to miniaturemarket.com where they have thousands of board games at discounted prices, and you can sign up for product alerts. Hello, my friends, the Game Boy Geek here. Today I'm joined by my friend,
Greg Dixon. Welcome to the top 10.
The top 10 games of all time. This has been a series of my 101 best games of all time. We've been going through 10 at a time for the last 2.5 months.
Yes, wow, that long.
Yes, and just before this video was released, I did a video by myself with these games where I told you how they're played to give you some more information about, like, mechanically, how do these games work. And then I also told you why I love them. But today is gonna be your fly on the wall in our living room as we just talk about these games. Greg has an envelope there. He predicted what were gonna be in my top 10 before we started this list. Two of them have already come up and they were shot down. They were a little too high. Go back and see videos 60 to 51 and 40 to 31 to see those ones.
I think
ones.
You're right. I feel good about this though.
I think he probably does have 8 of his 10 in my top 10 because he knows my tastes very well.
Because if these 8 aren't here, how did they drop off so far?
Yeah.
Now, I didn't predict the order. I just came up with 10 games that I was confident would be at least in the top 20, if not in the top 10.
So there you go. Here we go. We're going to start this with number 10. Now, before we jump into number 10, I wanted to let you in on a little practical joke that I played on Greg, just so you're kind of in on it, and you don't think I'm crazy for what happens here with my number 10 that's actually kind of fake. Greg often texts me pictures of games he's playing throughout the weekends and stuff, and one day, about 2 months ago, right, we started filming this 101 Best Games of All Time series. He sent me pictures of a popular cooperative game called The Game, and it's a game where you're trying to play cards and there's limited communication. And I texted back and said, hey, yeah, I like that game, but I like this other one a lot better called Okie Dokie. And I said, it kind of replaced the game for me. And he replied back with something like, yeah, you spoke highly of it and we tried it. We thought it was terrible and, you know, whatever. And he was joking around like, oh, we even like question all your judgment on games from now on because of that. You know, and I was just like, oh, so I texted him back and I said, well, you're gonna be surprised when we get to the top 10. And that was it. And I never heard anything back to him about that. So this time I figured a callback like 2 months ago as we first started filming the series that I wanted to put this in as number 10 and to act serious like it really is one just to get this crazy reaction on to see what would happen. So now that you kind of know like why I did this, you can watch this. If you don't want to watch this, you can look at the YouTube time index below and jump to the real number 10. Otherwise, have fun watching him look absolutely befuddled and getting a little bit of a rise out of him. All right, number 10. This is a small cooperative card game.
Are we not going to talk about the suit? Well, I'm so distracted by waka 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 waka.
Well, it's a special day, and you know.
I'm sorry. Number 10. Go ahead. Go launch into your intro.
It's a small cooperative card game.
Small cooperative card game.
It's in a small little box. It's just cards. There's limited communication, and you're trying to get all the numbers out, and that's it. And it is, it's
the game? Hanabi?
It's kind of like the game, but there's little animals with musicians.
Okie dokie?
What? How in the world did you guess this?
Dan, this game is in your top 10?
You guessed the game. It's just like the game.
Is this a joke?
It's better.
Am I being pranked? Where's Ashton Kutcher? Oh, sorry, old reference. I did not like this game.
I know
I'm sorry, TMG and whoever designed it. I did not like this.
I know.
We like beat it like the first time we played it.
Him and I texted about this like a few months ago, actually when we just started this list, and I said, and I go, oh, you guys are playing the game? Because he sent me pictures of the game, and I go, the game? I go, that game completely got replaced by Okie Dokie, and he's like, oh, I didn't like that game.
No.
That game was terrible. He goes, in fact, I started to question your judgment of games because of this.
And is this a joke?
And I texted you back and I said, well, then you're going to be surprised in the top 10. And you never responded
so
back to me.
So what is missing from your top 10 if this is that? Did I miss one along the way? I'm so baffled.
I can't believe that you don't like this.
We played it and it beat it. It was like the cooperative. So there's no communication, it's cooperative. It's just like the game and Hanabi and Mind, except it's super easy.
It's not easy. Did you play by the rules?
Yes, beat it the first time we played it.
Did you add extra rainbow cards?
I'm sure we played it on one of the easier settings, But we played, I remember we played, because we, I used to do a podcast called Hooked on Geek, and we talked about it. And I went back and listened to it even, and I was just like, why would anyone play this when the game exists, or The Mind, or Hanabi?
Because it's so much better than all those!
It's so not, now I know you like the musical theme.
It's a great solo game too, actually.
If you, well, I don't ever do solo.
I know, neither do I usually, but if you ever played that original, like, you know, the old school solitaire?
I'm sorry, folks, you can't listen to any of these choices, because he picked freaking Okie Dokie as a top. Okay, maybe it's a 100 is like, you know, there's just something about this. Oh,
do you know the old solitaire game with the card game where you just put the cards?
Sure,
in?
Like everyone's old PC had it.
Yeah, so like if you have like a grandma that likes to play that, you play this and it like destroys with that old solitaire
game. Okay, so it this is a game for grandmas that beats solitaire, a game that no one plays anymore because we all have iPhones. What the heck, dude? Okay, I'm baffled. I'm speechless. Because unless there's something missing, unless I messed up earlier, what has been dethroned that I was confident would be in a top 10?
All right, it's a joke.
This is a joke. It's got to be a joke.
It is a joke.
It is. It's another top 10, right?
Number 10 is really the best deduction game out
you
there.
You let that go for so long that I was like, okay, I guess this is real. I guess Dan and I can't be friends anymore.
I wanted to see how far you were going to go.
I was like spiraling. I couldn't believe it. I was like, so what game does this replace? Okay. Okay, you did this just to screw with me.
I did text him, though, when he sent
he
me that.
He does legitimately like this game, but I'm so glad
actually,
it's not
it actually
the top
just,
100.
It actually just missed my top 100. It was like 103 or something.
It's not very
but
good.
I did text him when he sent me that, and I said, you're going to be surprised in the top 10, and I got no
I
response.
I just thought you were joking then, like, oh, ha-ha, this is going to be a top 10
game.
I
was seeding it for this.
Okay, so you let this go for so long, I was starting to believe you. I mean, I was like, okay, all right. Okay, what's the real top 10?
The best pure logic deduction game ever.
Search for Planet X. See, I was going in my head like, so what's missing? Like, this is one of the ones I predicted as a top 10 game for you because you've been raving about this game ever since it came out.
Your wife, Stephanie, loves this game, too.
Everybody loves this game. If you like deduction.
Except you.
Of the deduction genre, this is a great game. It's just not my favorite genre, but this is a really cool game.
Yeah.
The way it's all, like, this is in relative to this. I mean, it's a brain burner. It's a real, like, well-designed logic puzzle if that's what you're looking for.
It is.
But see, these are the caliber of games, like, when I say caliber, like your caliber of game, then I'm like, must be missing if Okie Dokie's on there. I'm like, how can something like Search for Planet X not be on here if Okie Dokie is? Anyway, sorry, I'm still recovering. Breathe. The Search for Planet X is a game I only played once or twice, I think. I think I did pretty good, actually.
Yeah, you did.
But it also is one of those games like the Mystery Express game where you can like do predictions early and get points that way.
Yep.
So if you're like...
It took the mechanism from Mystery of the Abbey.
Yes.
Which was you can go make a revelation. Yes. But they actually like fixed it so it's not broken.
Yeah.
Because you could actually break the game in Mystery of the Abbey of doing that.
I could see that.
But this, they fixed it. Because
I think I figured it out maybe first, but you guys did better predictions or something
That's
like that.
That's another great thing about this. You don't have to be the first one to find Planet X.
Yeah.
The game ends that round, but someone else could find it and even get
if
more points.
If you could make good strategic assumptions early on, you still have a shot at it.
Yeah, you're publishing theories.
Yeah.
And it makes information flow faster. And
you let that go for so long, dude.
I was just waiting to see how far you because I could see you were perturbed.
I couldn't believe it. I was like, what? What is missing? Okay, sorry. We're derailing from what we should be doing, which is talking about Search for Planet X. Is this something you think they'll be able to expand?
Well, there's an expert side already.
Okay.
On the back, which makes the regular side's
it's already
hard enough.
Enough going on, yeah.
The expert side's like, you wouldn't need an expansion.
Because this has been a big hit for them.
Yeah.
So it'd be interesting to see if they could come up with, like, the search for something else, you know, the search for the lost asteroid, I don't know, something. Because the system is really good. Even for someone like me who's not really into deduction games, just because they feel too much like work, you know, and not enough like fun, which is, last I checked, the reason you play games. But I have to give it props because it is a great design.
Yep.
So it'd be interesting to see if you could do more with this. But yeah, like you said, it's already got so much going on.
Yeah. There you go. Search Planet X, number 10.
I knew it.
All right, number 9 is my favorite social deduction game.
Okie Dokie 2. The sequel. All right, your favorite what?
Social deduction game. that...
My favorite social deduction game.
Yeah. It has to do with asking a bunch of questions and trying to guide people to the right answer.
Interesting.
Yeah. And it has to do with werewolves as well.
Werewords. Mm. So this is... Oh, so what is not in your...
Ooh, okay. This one wasn't in your list?
No, I didn't predict this one.
Wow.
But there were two other games that I was wrong about, so I think this is just filling in one of those slots.
Oh, yeah.
I still think the other eight will be right, or it'll be in the family of what's right.
I see, yeah.
Okay, that makes sense. I forgot you hadn't said this one. I was thinking this one was really early on, because we brought it up a lot.
Yes, we've talked about it.
But that's right, it wasn't actually on the list. Okay, I know you love this one. And was Insider on your list?
No.
You never put Insider on the top 100?
No.
No, okay.
Because this is a
You think this one's that much better?
This is a better implementation of that core concept. There's way more roles, especially in the word deluxe.
But Insider is just so easy to teach.
Yeah, but you can...
Usually you like the more gateway version of it, so I'm kind of surprised Insider's at least not a top 100 game, but it sounds like this one just for you is so...
You can play this with the lighted Insider rules.
Oh, I see.
Unofficially. You could You could just make...
You could play basically Insider with these components to teach them the
very basic
idea
of how things work.
Okay, I see that. So it's almost like you put it in like a technicality.
Yeah.
Because I like Insider because I just think it's so elegant. And I feel like you can teach it with anybody.
I think this also plays more players too.
Wow, Insider goes up to... Ooh, is it 8?
Yeah.
Werewords might go higher than that. I can't remember. I do like Werewords, and Werewords is the sort of game you play over and over and over again. You play it, we're like, oh, let's do it again. Like, it's hard to play it just once.
Yeah. And there's so many different roles, too.
Yeah.
It's so fun, because we used to play 20 questions all the time with my mom, and even when we were riding down, driving down the street.
Yeah.
You know? And this is basically 20 questions.
Yeah.
But with the hidden identity aspect.
Now, what do you think of, like, the limit with, like, you can only ask so many times? Do you like that better?
I love that. Well, that's what makes the being a werewolf fun and hard and interesting is that there's different strategies there. Because everything's out on the table. So if you're bad, people are going to be like, well, who just wasted a bunch of tokens, right?
Yeah.
But then you catch on to that, and then the werewolf, like, you learn to, like, ask a lot of questions, but actually have a lot of them be good, be yeses, but they're still not really pointing you in the right direction.
Yeah.
Like, so it's really clever, I think.
Do you think it's...
So you can waste the tokens, because once they're gone...
Yeah.
So it's...
Do you think it's easier or harder to be the bad guy in Insider or Werewords?
I think it's harder in Werewords.
Yeah.
Because
with Insider, you've got that, and there's a ton, these are timed rounds too, right? Because you got the little, sand timer going in Insider, and I know, like, if they're not getting to it, you really feel that pressure of, like, I'm running out of time and I don't know how to direct them.
Yeah, same with this,
but that has that as
well. But actually having the finite tokens is another thing that really does set this apart from Insider.
Yeah, it's much. I think that makes it harder.
Yeah, but it also makes it more strategic too, because you can't just willy-nilly be firing off questions.
With Insider, you just...
And as you're rolling down and down, you're trying to think of better questions, but you also have to do it quickly.
Yeah. I don't know. I wonder if I'd played this one first, if I'd like it more or not. Because I think I played Insider a ton, and then I played Werewords. Yeah. And I was like, okay, but I was already kind of attached to Insider.
This is great, because you can bring it to a party and just play it with anybody.
Yeah.
Yeah. Werewords. I love it.
Okay, this doesn't shock me as much, because I remember there's two openings. For a second there, I was like, what was missing because of this? But I guess there's two openings.
There you go. Werewords, number 9. Number 8 is a cooperative word game, where you're trying to give clues and link together as many words as possible. And it's based off a Spiel des Jahres winner.
Oh my gosh. Codenames.
Yes, but which one?
A Duet. Yeah, you like Duet the most.
Yes.
So I think this was not predicted by me.
You think this was the other one? So you're going to get the rest of them?
I think the rest of them will be 100% right.
I think you're right too.
Or one of them will be in the same family.
Okay. Yeah, no, I think you're right.
Because I might have picked the wrong one in that family of games.
Because after this, we're getting to the super obvious ones. Yeah, but this...
But these last two, I know you love these. And this is one I really, really want to play again. Because I remember we played it a few times when you first got it. And I liked it, but it's been years now, or however, I feel like it's been...
Do you still play Codenames a lot?
No, I don't.
Why?
But partially because you do need a big group all the time, and there's so many good big group games.
You can play with 4. It's still really good with 4.
Yeah, but if you have 4, you're not playing a Codenames. At least I'm not. Because there's like, every game's good at four. You know what I mean? Like, well, but, you know what
like,
I'm saying?
But if you're in the group of like a casual party and there's only four of you, what are you going to pull out?
Stay cool.
Okay.
I mean, obviously, there's so many games. And we just talked about Insider. I mean, there's a ton of games that work well at four.
Yeah.
Skull. I mean, there's so many good ones.
This works at two.
Yeah, and that's
and
the
three,
thing.
And four, and five.
And like, that's the reason I really want to try it again.
I don't think this gets enough credit because most people think Codenames Sweat is only a two-player game, and it's not.
Yeah.
In fact,
I
played it with big groups, and it's just, it's even better than the original.
This came up organically in a conversation we were having just the other day, didn't
it? Yeah.
And I said the same thing. I was like,
it's great.
It's two-player. And you're like, no, it's more than that. I'm like, oh, yeah, I forgot.
It's great because it's like you're all working together, but this side is getting clues from the other side. Yeah. And you could swap off the... It doesn't matter who gives the clue. Us three are on the same team over here.
Right.
If any one of us comes up with a clue, let's just say it.
Now, remind me, was Codenames on your 100?
No. And I think that's mostly
it's
because...
It's kind of in the same...
Yeah.
It's almost like the Santorini thing.
Yeah, but I like this one so much more than the original that...
Yeah. And because you can't actually play it with teams.
And you can actually mix the contents of this game with Codenames.
All right, where does Codenames and Codenames Pictures rank for you?
Pictures I did not like.
Really?
It was only of the ones I didn't like.
Okay.
I felt like the
And then most
to be, like,
of the themed
clever.
Ones are all kind of like Codenames Pictures, aren't they?
Yes. And
you
they're
like,
all very
Disney
specific
and Marvel.
Knowledge.
Yeah, you have to really be into
that. I still really
like
the original one.
Yeah.
But I like this one better. The deductive aspect that they added to this just sends it to a different layer of depth.
So this might be off topic a little bit, but if you like Codenames and you know it, I think you were there. We played it one time, and this was something that was happening on social media at the time, but I feel like it's been long enough that people might forget about it.
You put board games down?
You do a grid of board games.
Yeah, I did that once.
I think you were in my house. Maybe not. I know I did it in my house. I can't remember if you were there that night or not. It was really fun.
Mm-hmm.
Because you can just look at the art and connect things just like you would with Codename Pictures or whatever. But you can also do it with mechanics
designers
and publishers and all that kind of stuff. So anyway, I don't mean to derail the top 100, but I just think that's such a fun, like, alternate way to play Codenames.
Yeah.
But yeah, do it. Now, this also has like a campaign too, doesn't it?
Yeah, you can play in different cities and it just changes the difficulty and the way that you have to give clues, either like more risky or more loosey, like more conservative.
Yeah.
It adds a little bit to it, but it doesn't like... It's fine. Like,
it's just slight tweaks to the rules as you go to different things.
Yeah, yeah. It just tweaks the difficulties.
Yeah.
But the best thing is the deductive aspect of there's three assassins, and you know that you know that this one assassin on my side is an assassin on yours, but I also know one of my assassins is something good on your side.
Yeah.
So like you have that. We also know that like three of the good ones for me are also three of the good ones for you. So when you get down to the end, you can literally like deduce certain things and rule out certain words that haven't been used yet based upon what has happened.
Now, when you teach this or when you play this, do you, like if you play this, do you play this with non-gamers?
Yes.
Do you do Codenames first and then do what?
This
you just
one's easier.
Do it?
And the reason why it's easier
really?
Is because in Codenames, you go back to back giving clues. In this one, if I'm a better clue giver than you or you're brand new, I can give a bunch of clues in a row, get the board to shrink, and then you can give your clue when you're ready.
Oh,
you don't. It's not turn-based.
That's
like
right.
You can freely take turns, and that's one huge reason why this is a better game, but even easier to teach.
Hmm. All right. Yeah, I'd dine to play this.
And you can use
again.
The original Codename cards with this, so you basically like double the amount of words.
As if there's so many words already. But
yep.
Yeah, I remember when I played the first Codenames, I was just like, "How is this game not already existed?" Yeah. And then I assume they learned from the first one and like, how can we make
People
this
always
even
say
more
that,
interesting?
Like, you want to play games that make you feel clever.
Yes.
This game, when you
Codenames
think
does
of
not
some
always
weird,
make you feel clever.
When you think of like a weird, obscure way to link three things that have nothing to do with each other, but you're able to get it and they were on your train of thought and they got it. There's not a lot of experiences in games that's like that. Period.
That's cool.
Codenames Duet, number 8.
All right,
number 7 is... The best modern classic economic pure game that's out there.
Economic game.
Economic. Most money wins, like in all those great economic games.
Hold on.
It has route building.
Ticket to Ride?
Route building,
no, that's not most
auctions,
money.
Resource management. Oh, come on. You've got to have this on this list. The most Euro sort of like...
I don't...
A classic. Older game.
I don't know if I have this one.
It's your favorite color.
Okay, I'm having such a like senior moment here. What am I, 100?
You're running
Power Grid?
Yes.
Haven't you already said Power Grid?
I have not.
Really? For some reason, I thought we already did Power Grid.
We've talked about Power Grid.
You talked about how it's been 2.5 months, so the early ones I'm like hazy on, man. And I never watched the original videos.
We've referenced Power Grid in conversations about other games.
Yeah. See, that's the problem. Same thing with
Werewolves. This wasn't on your list.
No.
Wait a minute. So...
I thought we'd already done this one, too.
I know, but even before, you didn't think...
No, because these other ones, well, because I was convinced of these other ones so much. Mm. Same thing with like Nothing Personal. It wasn't that I didn't think it was like a contender for the top 10.
We just recently went to the cabin where we played all of our favorite games. This was one of them.
Yeah, it was great.
And I brought all these extra components to light up all of the houses.
But I didn't think it was top 10.
Would you do that for a game you didn't love this much? Would you go through that trouble?
You got to look at it. I think it's your Instagram. You posted a picture, right?
It's crazy.
I did on mine too. Greg C. Dixon, although it's a while back. But yeah, we strapped little lights to every building.
They're like little finger lights to every building that you power up, and the whole thing is all lit up.
If you didn't have the resources to power it, it would be on, but not on, like on the house, but not turned on. And so it looked really cool by the end.
I'll try to remember to edit some of those clips in as we're talking about this.
Yeah, if not, you don't post on your Instagram that much. Just go to his Instagram and go back, you know, a month or whatever, and it's there.
Yeah.
Okay.
But even playing it recently,
how
much I love this
game. I think for me, I love this game, but it is kind of the same experience every time.
I guess.
You could say that about a lot of games, and also running the auctions, which cards you pull out, which ones you put in.
But what
a little
makes it
fiddly.
Different
now, it's still a top 100 contender for me, but I didn't think this was top 10 for you.
But what makes it different is the interaction with the players.
Yeah.
You're always constantly, you can't just do the same strategy every game.
No. Because
you've got to play off what other people are not doing.
Yeah.
What areas are they?
And the auctions. The auctions alone really change things up.
And blocking people and trying to like look at the board and tactically think, I got to get in there soon.
Have I run out? Am I missing one here?
I don't know.
I might have messed up on a prior. I might bring up a game and you'd be like, dude, I mentioned that. That was number 31. I'll be like, oh, really? I forgot.
Yeah, no, this is
a great game. This is a classic.
It's my favorite economic game, period. It's just so good.
I think I would have thought of Power Grid faster, but I kept trying to fit what you were saying into one of the ones on my list. So I'm like, this isn't working. That's why I think you had this like, oh, Drew, nobody's home. The lights are on. Yeah. Okay, Power Grid.
Love it.
Yeah, it's a great game.
Like, I would play it every day. I love it. It's just so good.
Everyone should play Power Grid if they haven't played it. And I remember when it was newer, I was a little scared off by it because people were like, oh, it's super mathy and all that. And it is. Although you talked about the lights, the other thing you did is you had those little counters.
Yeah, I bought some little counters off Etsy.
Pinterest or Etsy or one of those things.
Yeah, these little like hidden counters to keep track of money. And
which were really nice.
It worked really well.
Yeah.
You don't have to deal with like giving out change and all that sort of stuff.
Yeah. Power Grid is an excellent choice. It's definitely worthy of being on a top 100, arguably in a top 10.
Love it.
But I'm wondering if there's something missing as a result now.
Maybe. Number 7, Power Grid. Number 6 is a fun area control game that also has negotiation.
Oh, man. Lots of dice rolling.
Lots of dice rolling.
I knew this one. Okay. Lords of Vegas, baby. Yes. Lords of Vegas is so good.
This game is so underrated.
So under-discussed, so under-talked about, so under-appreciated.
It's so good.
Yeah.
You have to be okay with luck. There's ways to mitigate it, but it is Vegas.
Yeah.
The theme comes through.
That's the thing. Is like I excuse the fact that you can win with good luck because it's a Vegas game.
Yeah.
That's the whole point of it. So they've taken the theme of being at Vegas, but then sort of pasted it on to the theme of developing Vegas, being in the early days of creating Vegas.
It's a really cutthroat game. You're building up casinos and remodeling it to take over someone else's casino.
And you can still like min-max it. Like you could go, okay, assuming the dice rolls go as they statistically should, and so you can maybe have some luck that helps you, but you can still play it sort of at, not as a Euro, but you know what I mean? Like there's still that element of
it. Sure.
Because you can be like, is this a risk worth taking or not?
Yep.
And you're constantly, and everything you do in this game is a gamble. Every action.
Everything.
Including just gambling. Just going to one of your opponent's casinos and going, I'm going to try to make some money and rolling the dice and hoping it works.
Yeah.
And it's fun because sometimes you're like just shy of what you need to do some big move.
Yeah.
And so you're like, all right, I'm going to roll the dice. And you know the odds are against you, but you go for it anyway.
Yep.
So when you were talking about like nothing personal.
Yeah.
Like, this is one of the ones I thought of. This one and, like, Tammany Hall that also have negotiation. They also have that element of you know, making alliances and betraying each other and all that kind of stuff. But I just think the structure is cleaner and better in those games. In those in this, two than in Nothing Personal.
Yeah.
Those are just... That one's too open. Whereas this scratches the Nothing Personal... This one and Tammany Hall.
Yeah.
They scratch the Nothing Personal itch for me. As does Corporate America and Article 27. Other ones you've discussed.
Yeah.
But with like a little bit better structure, I think.
Yeah.
They're all good. They're all in the same family of games. And those are the kind of games we were playing at that cabin weekend.
Yeah. This one... always goes over well.
Can I tell the story about Lords of Fake? You can edit it out if you want to.
Which one?
Well, I have a picture of Dan when he calls. You know how when people call you, like their picture pops up? And Dan's a good guy. He's a wholesome individual. But Lords of Vegas sets him off like no other game. And the picture I have of Dan when he calls is him playing Lords of Vegas with me and flipping me off.
But do you remember what you did in that game?
I'm sure I screwed you over. I mean, that's all you do in this game is you screw everyone else over. And I like snapped a picture right when you flipped me off. And I'm like, oh yes, this is the picture I want every time Dan calls me.
Yeah, this game's mean.
Yes.
You mess with other players.
But you go into it knowing that. Yeah. You go into it knowing it's lucky. Now, it's not just, oh, it's a bunch of rolling dice. There's some really cool design aspects to this, too. The idea that you score points as you go up.
Yeah.
But then in order to continue to move up the score track, you have to score two points at a time.
Yeah.
So you have to set yourself up so that later on you're not just getting a point again. You have to get 2 points at a time and then 3 points at a time and four points at a time.
Yeah.
And if you get 3 points in a turn but you need four, you don't advance on the score track. And so it really forces you to continue to like, and that's what forces you to be mean to everyone else because the area is so finite and you have to like invade into other people's space in order to keep moving up that score track.
It's fun.
I love it.
It has everything. Negotiation, area control.
Expansions are all good.
All really good.
You can play without the expansions. It's still great. You can mix and match.
And if you have poker chips, throw away the paper money and play with the poker chips. It does make it a lot more
fun.
Although
I do like they have like Frank Sinatra and some of the old timey like Vegas acts on the money. That was a fun touch.
Yeah.
But I'm with you.
Super underrated game. Lords of Vegas, number six.
Yeah.
Number five.
Top five.
You know, the tagline of my channel is breaking down barriers, growing relationships through board games by helping you find the next one you love. And all the experiences that we've been talking about, all these, my favorite games of all time, they give you experiences. But, like, none of those experiences match up for me, personally, of watching someone that's never played these types of board games before and watching them, their eyes light up and watching them go, I never knew this world existed.
Yeah.
And you kind of like help them in this. And this next game, and that feeling for me is better than any feeling I get from playing a game.
Oh, yeah.
Just watching them light up and walking them through all this stuff. And this game is number one, best one ever to do this with, is to get new people to play games.
Oh, I know.
It's the modern day classic of these days. And if anyone that hears I do board game stuff, they go, what game should I own? Without even thinking, this is the one.
Yeah. Ticket to Ride?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah, this is like the Catan was that game for a generation. I think this was like the next game in that series of just becoming this smash hit because it's just the right balance of design and opening you up past the Monopoly and Clue and all that to something new without being overwhelming. And it's just right.
If you think it's so. We always use the word elegant, but like...
Yes, it is.
This is like, the turns are quick. There's a lot of tension in this game.
Yeah.
You're like looking where you have this hidden goal. You're looking where you want to go and someone else blocks you and it can be a little mean at times. But like, essentially, you've got rummy style card set collection. You've got route building.
Yeah.
You've got hidden objectives.
Yeah.
You've got blocking, the abstract aspects of... There's actually...
Set collection.
There's everyone like... All like the gamers like crap on this game, like, oh, it's so light. There's actually a decent amount of stuff going on.
And if you want a heavier experience, there's 12 other versions of it that are heavier experiences.
Sure.
So I'm not a big Ticket to Ride fan, but I recognize that there is a Ticket to Ride for anybody, I think.
Yeah.
There's some to avoid, but
there's so many expansions too, but
yes.
I've never brought this out with people that, and most of the time I'm bringing it out to people that haven't played games, and I've never seen it not go over well. And almost always they go out and buy it. Like
this is like one of the safest bets for a gateway game if you're trying to get people into gaming. I agree with you there. It does introduce a lot of elements that they're going to see in other games going forward.
And it can be, but you can also play this, you can play it very casually, talking it up, playing stuff, having a game on the background.
Yeah.
But you can also play this like, seriously, you can know, like, I had the base cards, like the tickets, like memorized.
Well, if you play it enough,
And so like, if I see someone go from here to here, I already know, most likely, it's like, okay, they got the Seattle, New York. Or they've got the Vancouver to Phoenix.
Like, that's crazy. Like I never played it that much.
And so you could play it at like a high level like that. And even if someone's like doing the thing like, well, I don't start or end where I'm supposed to go. That's too obvious. You could start in the middle. And as soon as you start to go somewhere, I could tell which ticket you had.
Yeah.
And I could block you. Like you can play this at
a very cutthroat level.
At a very high level with a lot of strategy
that's
and stuff.
That's why I don't play this with him.
But I typically don't play it that way. I'm usually teaching people.
Now, here's my thing. I kind of burned out on Ticket to Ride early. And I played some of the other versions, and some of them are really great. But I sort of replaced it, although I hate doing that. But, I mean, that's sort of what happened just organically with, like, Royals and Ethnos.
Yep.
And I wonder what you think of those games similar kind of gateway experiences.
Yeah, they are similar. And it's the reason why I love both of those games is because it's kind of picks up where this left off.
Yeah, I think.
But it's also for two different things. But the odd thing is I still, if it was like just us and our gamer friends, and you had those three games and you said,
you'd still pick a Ticket to Ride.
I still
would. Really?
Just because I just love it. It's just, it's like what do they call it? The home cooking or like, what do they call it? Comfort food?
Yes.
This is my comfort game.
Yes.
Where it's just so familiar.
Well, and I think when you're putting together a top 100 list, there's certain games that are on there. There's sort of like three categories of games, I think. And you have to tell me if you agree with this. There's games that are on there that are just pure nostalgia. Just, I played this a ton. I love it. And then there's games that are the new hot thing that you're excited about and it skyrockets up on the list. And then there's the games that are both, right? Where it's like, I have a lot of nostalgia and memories and good times, you know, in my memory banks of this game. And I still play it all the time. Like, it's still the new. It's still something that gets to the table.
Yeah.
It's still an evergreen.
I still play this a ton.
Yeah, and I think Ticket to Ride for you is absolutely that game. Because it's a game you played years and years ago, and you have lots of memories with lots of different plays over the years, but you still pull it out. And that's really rare to
have
a game.
And they have the really cool, big, ginormous versions that were, like, limited edition. Yeah. But you, like, the Europe one's still for sale now. It just came out, the big, giant version. And plus, having all those expansions, they really changed the game a lot. Kind of like how the Power Grid maps changed the game. This changes the game, so each one plays a little differently, right? And so... Yeah. If you get sick of the original, there's a lot more to explore.
Yeah,
but for me, it's because it's the easiest and best, most sure bet when you're introducing someone new to gaming.
It is one of the safest bets, absolutely.
There you go, Ticket to Ride, number five. Number four is a medium weight, pretty crunchy thinking puzzly game.
Yes, it sure is.
Oh my gosh, he already knows it.
It's got to be Five Tribes.
Oh my gosh.
Well, I mean, you love Five Tribes. It's like was in your logo at one point, wasn't it?
Yeah, it might still be.
Yeah, there it is. I can see it right now.
For those of you, if this is your first time watching one of these videos, you can go back. And he's actually pretty good at guessing all of them. I try to play this little guessing game, but he's going to know these because he just knows my favorite games.
Yeah.
Yeah, this, oh my God, the puzzle of this.
So the opposite of Ticket to Ride. Don't play this with gateway gamers.
No. This game, I think, is an absolute masterpiece of, it's like a point salad.
Yeah.
With Mancala.
With a spatial puzzle.
A spatial puzzle that changes every game, and even within the game.
Right.
It changes every turn.
And every game you have like, every turn, you have exponentially more things to consider.
Well, as the game goes on, you actually kind of have less.
I guess there's like a peak of that, and then it starts to taper off, right?
Yeah, you have the most decisions at the beginning, and then as things go, it's less and less. But, oh my God, like the puzzle of this, I mentioned it in my previous videos, like when this was coming out, Z Garcia from the Dice Tower and I were, this is Z's favorite designer too. And we were both really excited. Gen Con opened first day, first morning, we ran to the table, Bruno was there teaching it. And I was like kind of nervous because it's like you want to. I thought I would like it from reading about it, and yeah. You want to like it, but you never know.
What year was that?
I don't remember.
I thought it was older than that.
2015.
Somewhere in that range. Okay, so you were already doing your channel and stuff.
Yes, I don't remember. Yeah,
it kind of feels like it's been around forever.
It has been for a while.
Yeah.
But I remember playing it, and I remember both like three turns in. I remember Z and I looking at each other and going. Oh my gosh. Like, yes, this is exactly what we hoped it was going to be.
So this has got to be the highest Cthulhu on your list.
It's not.
Ah.
But the aspect of this is that puzzle.
Yeah.
And the fact that you can, like, go through all these permutations in your head looking at this. It plays great with all player counts. It plays very different at two because you can actually set yourself up in the bidding to get two turns in a row. So as you're dropping the meeples off, you can actually set your turn up for your next turn before the other player gets it.
And you talked about before how he's like he was a chess player.
He's a competitive.
And so that's an element of that, of being able to look a few turns out.
But the fact that there's that one mechanism in Kala.
Yeah.
But you have set collection of like the green market cards.
Yeah.
And then you have like the builders looking at like how the tiles are laid out. Mm-hmm. And then you have all the genies that have all the crazy powers.
Mm-hmm.
Then you have the assassins that are like killing to combo to take over other tiles. Or to kill somebody else's people to try to have majorities. There's a lot to think about.
So as you talk about all the like the options, what do you say to people who are worried about like the AP potential?
There could be a lot of downtime. If someone is prone to analysis paralysis in your group, this is probably not the game for them.
No, it's not.
It's not. This isn't for everybody.
Do you play it? I mean, do you feel like you've played it enough now that you're able to kind of min-max it really quickly? Or do you still just kind of go by your gut?
No,
do you find like a blend? Or
you get a lot faster at looking for the patterns of what you're looking for.
Right.
It comes a lot faster.
Yeah.
But it doesn't make it any easier.
Sure.
You're just quicker.
Yeah.
And the decisions are still like awesome. Like and then it's like, the coolest thing is like you at the beginning of the round, you look at this, you're like, oh my gosh, this is a really cool move. I hope no one else sees it. I'm going to bid 5. And then someone goes, I'm going to bid 8. And then they take your move, and you're like, I should have bid 8. But you're bidding points. It's like, well, they bid 8, and they only got 16 points off it. Now I was able to bid 5, and maybe because of what he did, changed my move, and now I ended up doing what? It's just.
And there's been a few expansions, right? 3 or 4?
Yeah, and the expansions are great. It adds a 6th tribe. And
do you feel like
never play it with the first time with those things, but like.
Yeah, so play it with base first.
If I'm playing with someone that's already playing
this. Are there any expansions to you that are like essential?
No, the base game's
You're
awesome.
Happy with the base game, but you're also happy. Do you mix and match expansions when you play with them usually, or just pick one at a time?
No,
kind
you just
of?
Put them all in.
Oh, you put them
all
in?
There's one main one, and there's one other smaller one that's like a side thing.
How many times do you think you should play the base game a couple times before you throw it all in, or what do you think?
There's enough at the base game,
yeah.
I'd say
play it a lot.
3 or 4. You can get a lot of. You can play this with never playing the expansions. Yeah. It's still awesome.
That's cool.
Yeah.
Good choice.
5 tribes. I know it's not one of your favorites.
I like it. I've always enjoyed it. It's not one I ever picked up or anything, but I've never played it and thought it was bad.
I actually just bought a bunch of like meeple stickers and camel stickers and all like stuff to to upgrade it a little bit.
Oh, that's cool. Yeah. Was it like some third party?
It was like Etsy or something.
Yeah. I've seen some of that more and more on social media.
Yeah, because as I was looking at the list, I'm like, I really need to trick that game out. I did it for Power Grid. I might as well do it for my favorite ones. Yeah. There you go. 5 tribes, number 4. You're going to say, should have been number 5.
Right? Yes, 5 tribes.
No, I like this
game of 49. Come on,
this is a personal favorite of mine. 5 tribes. Number 3. You're gonna get this very quickly.
I'm ready.
It's a card game.
Skull King.
That's ridiculous. Well, you think he knows me a little bit? Well, we've only been playing games like 3 times a week for 9 years.
I love this game too. And you mentioned some other trick-taking game earlier on the list. And you said, we talked about how there's more trick-taking games. And I'm like, yeah, there has to be Skull King.
Yeah.
And it has to be in the top 10. If this wasn't the top 10, I would have been so shocked.
Yeah.
Even more shocked than you putting Okie Dokie in the top 10. I would have been shocked if this was missing.
Now, this definitely isn't the trick-taking game I would recommend if you
don't
love trick-taking and you haven't played a decent amount of them. Because
this is a hard trick-taking game.
There's a decent amount going on. And it's very unforgiving.
Yeah, because you only score if you get your bid exactly.
Exactly right, which is hard to do.
It's crazy hard to do.
Yeah, and the scores could be very swingy. Your first game, you're going to lose -300 and someone's going to have like 700.
Even though the score is crazy swingy and people always come back, it doesn't bother me.
It doesn't.
I think in a lot of games it would, But something about Skull King, I think because you always feel like you can come back.
Although this new version does have a variant that's a lot easier to get new players into.
It scores different somehow or something?
Yeah, you don't get, you'll never get minus points.
Yeah, I still have the old school version. Yeah. My cards are all beat
up. I just
up.
Bought this new version. Actually, it's right behind your head right now. Like, I'm looking at it.
It's coming for me.
Yep. So this is just, and I've been telling people that this is my favorite trick-taking game for a while, and I guess I shouldn't be surprised, but like, tons of other people have messaged me and been like, yeah, it's my favorite.
Oh, people
it's
love
my favorite.
This game. Yeah, it's really beloved.
It's based off of Wizard, which was based off of, I can't remember.
I don't remember.
But it's based off of the trick-taking game Wizard, but it adds more layers.
Well, there's this whole hierarchy of like trump suits and you know, extra powerful cards that Wizard doesn't have. But the basic idea that Wizard does have of bidding and trying to get your bid in order to get points is there.
The simultaneous bidding is great. The slamming on the table and yelling yo-ho-ho like a pirate, which is in the rules. It tells you to do it.
If you like trick-taking games, this is for you. But it's not for everybody. No. It's really kind of an... I mean, it's not... I don't want to oversell it as being super complex.
Right.
But it's just hard to score consistently if you're not good at trick-taking games. If you can't... If you don't understand the rhythms of trick-taking games and how to bid and sort of... Because you have to sort of calculate. You look at your hands and go... Okay, these cards are great when there's three or four cards in my hand, but if there's 10 cards in my hand, times all the players, especially if you play six.
That's the other thing, is like hand one, you only have one card to bid on.
But it's good actually because, and that's one thing that is nice, because you can kind of teach and learn in those first few rounds.
And still come back.
And it doesn't matter if you don't do as well because people aren't able to get that many points.
Yeah. So it's like a pyramid. So by the 10th round, you get 10 cards.
Yes.
The other cool thing is if you zero bid, you get 10 times the round number. So like you might be behind with like minus 200 points. If you can zero bid like in round 7, 8, and 9, you're going to get 70 points and 80 points and 90 points.
Or
minus 70. You take one card, you're getting minus 10
it's
times.
It's a huge swing.
It's tense. It's fun. It's the best. Period.
Yeah, it's just.
It's your favorite trick-taking game too.
Yeah, I mean there's a top three or four for me and it's up there. It's probably, I think it's my favorite.
Yeah.
I love it.
If you like trick-taking games, you gotta play Skull King.
Yeah.
There you go, number three. All right, number two. I bet you he could guess without even me giving a clue.
Well, the problem is I think I have three, unless I messed up somewhere along the way.
This is my last Bruno Catala game. He had 20% of my top 10.
Yeah, so this is Mr. Jack, but it's the New York?
It is, and that's the new box cover.
Yeah, and this is what I talked about when I said I think I'd have it, but maybe the wrong one in the family of games, because I just put Mr. Jack.
Yeah.
Because I couldn't remember which one you liked the most. I know
you
like all
so
of
I
them.
Yeah, and so I had Mr. Jack Pocket on the list earlier.
Right.
And this is the only other one. The other two I like, but they weren't
so
top 100.
So Mr. Jack is not top 100 for
it's
it.
It's actually my least favorite of the four.
Wow, okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
I still like it.
No, we replayed this one recently.
Yes,
not too long ago.
Last week,
and then I realized then like I think my list is wrong.
Yeah.
Because you were like, oh, I love this, and you're talking about how good it was. Like, oh, he likes this one more than Mr. Jack. I didn't realize
this is sort of like a it's kind of an abstract game, and kind of pseudo hidden movement where somebody one's playing Jack and you're trying to escape, and the other player is trying to figure out which one of those characters are actually you.
Well, there's a lot of deduction games where what you're trying to figure out isn't really related to any of the players. There's a bunch of cards hidden somewhere. Whereas this one, what you're trying to figure out is the other person.
Yep.
And so that's a cool twist on it. I mean, this is an absolutely awesome design. There's so many ways to like bluff and double bluff, and then the more you know the abilities and all that, the more depth you're going to find. The downside, we talked about this, is... finding someone that you could play it with a lot.
It's a real problem with this game.
Yeah, because I could see, I imagine you're really good at it, and I also imagine it's hard for you to find people to play with that are like worthwhile, you know, challenges.
Yeah.
You'd have to kind of play it with the same people and grow together.
Yeah, I've played this more than 250 times but you used to be able to play it online. So I've played this, a ton online, but also a ton in person.
Yeah.
And, we were talking about it a little bit this after we played the other week, and it's if you're new to the Mr. Jack series, this is not the best one to start with. In fact, this is probably the one I would play last because...
Pocket's probably the first one, right?
Pocket's the best one to start with, Mr. Jack Pocket. This one has the most going on. You have the most freedom. It's the most open world. There's the most ramifications. It's the most riskiest. It's the hardest to figure out. There's a lot going on here. Mechanically, it's pretty easy, but there's a lot of abilities.
There's a lot to keep track of.
You create the board as the game's being played. Now, we talked a few times earlier about some games that I like was like, you know what, I didn't even really love this, and I got rid of it. We talked about it, Azul at one point, and some of the other ones. This
Mr.
one.
Mr. Jack?
Both of them. The both first one them. And this one.
Really?
Played them and was like, okay, it's good.
That must have been a long time ago.
Yeah, it was early.
Yeah.
But much like some of these other ones, I kind of got somehow either got another copy or wanted to play it again. And this one in particular was, and you were talking about earlier, after we played it, you're like, this is one of those games, and this game came out a long time ago. It's like 12 years ago.
Yeah.
And back then, people were playing games more because there were less games. Where now, if you're not wowed off your seat after the first play, right. there's 1,000 other games that might do that for you, so you just push it off to the side.
You have to kind of like put in the work with this one. You have to play it 3, 4, 5 times. This one or Mr. Jack, any of them.
Even more.
To really start to click and for you to realize the elegance of it.
That's what happened. I played it 2 or 3 times and I was like, okay, it's good. But then after going back and starting to play it online a bunch and then going, oh my gosh, this game has more layers of onions than any game. When you can play a game over 250 times and it still gets better and you're still learning things and you're still seeing cool little tricks you can do.
Right.
Like that shows the level of design that this is. And by the way, this is co-designed by Ludovic Malblanc, who's probably one of the most underrated board game designers. He's not talked about a lot, but he does a lot of stuff with Bruno, and he doesn't get a lot of credit.
Yeah.
He's amazing, and he's not one of the names that people like rattle off.
Yeah, you don't hear it as often.
But you're right. This is a hard game to find people to be competitive with because it takes a while. This is the only game I've ever written like a quick start guide, like a strategy guide, where like after so many plays online, I've figured out that it usually takes about 10 plays for someone to like get to the point where they can actually start to be competitive. So I've like got that. After you've played the game once, you could read this guide and go, okay, I could be competitive in the next game because I kind of know what to look out for.
Yeah.
And so I've been trying to, I can help people get up faster because it is, because the online thing broke.
You're like recruiting people.
The online thing broke and you can't play it anymore.
Really?
But so you can only play in person. But I agree with what Greg's saying. This isn't something that's going to wow you off your first play.
No.
You need to put in the work and play it. And like, if you like games, that if you're the type of player that wants to play a game and really like an Eric Martin who loves to from Board Game Geek, who is all about getting all the little small little nuances of a game on and playing it 50 more times.
Yeah.
If you're that type of player, then this game can be for you. If you like sort of abstract chessy thinking moves ahead, but with special abilities, that's it. And that's why this game is so high, because it still gets better after 250 plays.
Yeah, I feel that way about games too. Like, I like to find a game and really play it over and over and over again and see if it still surprises me and try to milk the strategy and really kind of peel the onion and find all the layers to it. But not all games work that way.
Right.
Not all games last.
Right.
They burn out. And I do think that with newer games, especially because there's so much competition, like you alluded to, a lot of people are just going, I just want this to be really fun splash the first few times, because people might only play this 2 or 3 times before they just move on
and
to the
new
thing.
And this is not the game for you if that's you. Do you think, even with, I mean, you've played it a couple times now. Like, do you think if you were to play it more and I was just like,
bring you
along and show you some of the layers?
Yeah.
Because I
recognize
like
it's there and I appreciate it. And I do, and you have me chase you. I think I would enjoy running more, although I think you would catch me a lot of times before I could actually fool you.
Right, and that's usually why I teach me the chaser first, because I can go, now I could do this or I could do this.
You need to understand that side to chase effectively, too, so I do understand why you would teach that side first.
Yeah,
I think the game, I think the hobby is more, it's like a catch-22, because you want to bring people into it, but as a result, I think there's less focus on the games like this, less of these sorts of games that come out that reward lots of play.
Yeah, even less so these days.
Yeah.
People are going to have less patience.
Yeah.
They're going to have less because there's just too much
to
go
see.
It's like squirrel, squirrel, squirrel. Like no one has attention span anymore.
Well, it reminds me of like video games. I think a lot of people are coming into board games from like the video game space, and there's a lot of focus on not only the new game, but now the new console, and it's always the new.
Yep.
Whereas I think with board games, part of what's for me that's rewarding about them is that a good game will still be good 30 years from now. It won't matter what's happened with technology and all this kind of stuff. A good design, you can open that box, it's going to be fun now. It was fun in 1980, it was going to be fun in 2060 or whatever, you know.
Yeah.
And it doesn't need anything extra
above
that. Just if it's good, it's all in that box and it'll still be good.
8 different special abilities, abstract style movement. tenseness that I can end the game now and escape, right, putting you under pressure of, oh my gosh,
well, he could
win
this round. Well, the tenseness the other side too of like, yeah, they might discover me.
Yep.
They might take a stab after narrowing it down and they might get me, yeah, you know.
It's good.
And then just the order that the abilities come out, right? Because you have, that's all randomized.
It's a great mix of, yeah, luck and strategy.
Yeah.
There you go, Mr. Jack New York. That's why it's my number two. All right, here we are, coming up to number one. And you have two left on your list.
I think I have
list.
Two left. Now, it might be that one of them was mentioned and I forgot to, you know, hey, this was, you know, that was one of my top 10 predictions.
Well, this is a card game. A tactical card game.
Okay.
That
it's sports themed?
Yes, it is.
I mean, we talked about this earlier. I knew this would be in your top 10, but okay.
So we'll talk about the other
one. We'll talk about this. We'll talk about the other one later. We'll figure out what went wrong.
This is another one where you're like, you know, whatever. I like deck. You like deck building, but you don't love this one. But
yeah,
we talked about Football Highlights 2052 in the previous video.
This one, would you say, is more dependent on needing to like the sport to enjoy the game? Because it felt too baseball-y for me.
Yeah, it's pretty baseball-y.
Yeah. I do love that it's futuristic and you have, like, you know, human machine hybrids, like, hitting that ball out of the park.
Like we talked earlier about, like, two-player-driven, card-driven games, like 1960, Making of the President,
right,
Twilight Struggle.
Yeah.
Like, really, games that have a lot of depth, but it's all in the cards and how you play them. And this, to me, is the absolute best of this, where it's like, I'm playing something and you're playing something. And I'm playing something and you're playing something. We both have different strategies. But as we play, our teams get better and better.
Yeah.
But unlike most deck builders, when you buy your next player, it's on top of your deck, which means if you buy somebody, I know you have that card
right away,
the very next game, which means
I'm
going to try to buy something that's going to help stop that.
Yeah.
And if I do, you're going to go, maybe I'll put him on deck and I won't use him this game and he'll waste the guy that he just bought to cancel me.
That's
a
cool.
lot of like double, cool. a lot of like double think.
Yeah.
Right. And then it's just the whole idea of and knowing your deck and knowing when like, okay, I'm stuck. I had this plan. I know the card that I bought three rounds ago. I haven't used yet. It's in this deck. Can I top deck it and luckily get him? And sometimes you do and sometimes you don't, but like there's that aspect. It's just tactical card games I love.
Yeah.
And this, it's the best one. It's. I love that you can play two player, but I love that in one box you can play a four player tournament, which is so fun because you play all other players, three games each, and each game takes 5 to 7 minutes. And then when you're done, you take the first seed and the four seed and they play 2 out of 3 and the other two play 2 out of 3 and then you have a final. It's just so fun because like, you walk into some of these games and you're like, it's very different. Like if you're playing a tournament, I'm sitting next to someone, I don't know what their deck is built with. And I just have to go at it.
Yeah.
But when you play a two-player game, I know everything that's in your
right.
deck. So it's like two completely different experiences. But
all
they're
in
both,
the same box.
But in all in the same box.
Well, I think for you, this game, don't let me put words in your mouth, but it's a good design as a board game, but it's also emulates something that you love, baseball.
Right.
And I mean, it just is like made for you.
Yeah, and they
and you're not a big deck building fan, but you like this, which is to its credit as well.
I know.
The fact that it sort of overcame a mechanic that you don't care about to still be your number one game is to its credit, for sure.
There's an app for it. You can play it online. You can play online with people.
Yeah.
So that's
really
great.
Cool.
That's really good. You can, for $6, you can get the app and like you can test to see if you'd like the game. But yeah, it's another one that, like, kind of like Mr. Jack in New York, you've got to spend some time with it. This was also one, the first 2 or 3 times I played it, I went, it's good.
Yeah.
And then, like,
I never got past those first 2 or 3, so I need to play it more.
It slowly grew
on
me.
But here's the problem. You've now gotten, same thing with Mr. Jack. I played it a few times, didn't click for me, but you've since, like, skyrocketed up. So it's like, I can't really play these with you now.
No, you could. I feel like when I play with new players, I never play to win. I only play to, hey, this guy out here, he's probably your best buy because
you have to build
this
opponents.
Guy. Yeah. But I'm like that in other games too. I usually am like pretty helpful when I'm teaching new players. Like,
yeah.
But this one just has legs. And again, I've played this so much.
Yeah, a ton.
And it's still, like Mr. Jack in New York,
it
still gets better with every play, which is hard to say for
games.
We've
got Mike Fitzgerald who's been designing games for like decades. I mean, he's his bread and butter is card games. So it makes sense that he was able to take the modern deck building and, you know, integrate it with his experience with building, card games for so many years and really turn out something that's going to really hit for the right potential gamer.
Yep.
Cool.
People that like two-player, like, combat-style games, yeah, if you don't mind dipping your toes in a sports theme,
yeah,
it has that sort of, I'm canceling this. Well, yes. I'm canceling that.
Yeah.
Well, I'm canceling this.
Yeah.
Oh, you just bought that card. I know you've got that big guy that hits two and runs.
You know, I do kind of the I do sort of the same thing with, like, Shards of Infinity or, yeah, Tyrants of the Underdark, yep, or something like that. For me, it's the same idea, but I don't have to care about baseball. I can just play, you know, the generic themes oftentimes, or D&D themes. But it's the same idea. Where, and I do love those sorts of games, which makes me think with more plays, just like you, took you a few plays to kind of get to the point where you really appreciate it. Yeah. I have to wonder if I were to do that, if at some point I'd be like, you know what, I actually really love this little game.
It didn't help that the first time we played it, I, like, demolished.
I'm sure you did. I'm sure you did.
Yeah, and I wasn't doing it on purpose, but.
Yeah, it happens.
All right, number one, Baseball Highlights 2045.
There you have it.
All right, well, there's my top 100 games of all time, or
101.
And this was 10 of 1. Did you have that as my number one, you think, the last one?
I mean, I knew it was a top 10. I didn't rank them, but I thought it could potentially, yeah, be a number one. I thought Five Tribes could be. I thought Mr. Jacks could, yeah, be. I mean, there were a few that I thought were contenders for that top spot. It was one of them, for
okay,
sure.
Okay, so in your envelope, before we started, there, yes, were 10 games you thought were in my top 10.
Yes.
Two of them came out way before.
Yeah, weeks back.
So you had 8 back.
And then I got everything, yeah, but there was one that's left over. Now, we have to get down to the bottom of it because I'm worried that it came up and I forgot to, like,
probably,
reveal at
I'm
that
guessing.
Point.
I'm guessing. Because if it's not, then that means you put a game in my top 10 that wasn't in my top 1.
Top 1.
We must
How
have,
is that possible?
No, we probably just...
We must have made a mistake. Okay. Yeah. You ready for the reveal?
Drum roll, please.
Do you want me to show you the card?
No,
okay. It was Forbidden Island.
Not in it.
That's not a top 10 game for you? So we talked about nostalgia and how that plays such a,
yeah,
part in it.
You're right.
And to me, Forbidden Island is a game, from what you've said, that to me, like, you can credit the whole channel, all this. I look around at all these games. I look at the cameras and lights and all of it came,
yes,
because of that game, right?
It's
That's
true.
What brought you back into, like, gaming.
It is.
And so I kind of, and I know you still enjoy it.
Yeah.
It's still a good design.
I still love it.
It holds up to me as one of the, like, I like it better than Pandemic, arguably. I mean, I think it's one of those great classic sort of cooperative games.
Yeah.
And so I'm a little surprised that one, I mean, look, I thought it would be at least the top 20. I've been saying that since the beginning.
Yeah.
But maybe it just doesn't come out like it used to. I mean, you tell me.
I was actually just looking up to see where it was on the list.
Because, like, I was pretty convinced that was a top 10. I didn't think it would be a number one game. But I,
yeah,
thought just off of the nostalgia alone, and because of what it means to you as, like, how it sort of launched you into this venture.
Yeah, I think...
Because wasn't that the game that someone taught you at some family event?
Yeah.
And you were like, oh, what other new cool stuff is out? And,
yeah,
and kind of got you curious about all this, right?
Yeah. So that's actually,
explain yourself,
it's
Dan.
It's a good pick. I am surprised that you would have had it in my top 10, but I'm also kind of surprised at myself that it didn't make my top 100. So,
like, what do you rank it? Is it not a 9 or 10 for you?
I remember it used to be a 9.
Okay.
I remember it dropped to, like, an 8.
Okay.
Somewhat recently.
So maybe all these are 9s and 10s and it just eked out? Do you...
No, I think as low as... I think... 8.5 was about as low as that was,
okay,
making my top 100. So it may have just missed. I was just looking now, trying to look for it. I didn't see it.
Yeah.
But I'll go back afterwards and look.
Do you feel like this was a mistake or an,
no,
omission? Or do you, like...
That's why I want to go look at my list.
I may
have, like, accidentally deleted it in, like, the row of the spreadsheet. But no, I do know that it was a 9 at one point, and I do,
okay,
think it went to an 8.
So it slipped a little bit.
And
for
I do
you.
Remember that, like, I think the cutoff was, like, usually 8.5s, so I think is where it gets. So may have just missed it.
It's still.
But you're right from a nostalgic perspective.
And it still feels like something, because look back at those lists. Think about how many of your games, when you're describing why you like them, you say, well, it's a gateway game.
Yeah.
It's a great way to teach, you know, it brings people in. All those sorts of things that you've been, like, as mantras almost repeated,
yeah,
throughout the top 100. Forbidden Island absolutely is that.
Yeah,
it's one of the great. It's one of the great cooperative games to teach people.
Yeah.
But yet you can, I mean, there's all kinds of boards online. People have done, like, threads,
yeah,
on BGG about new ways to
arrange the island.
I'll
tell you why it dropped was, number one, because I almost never stray from Ticket to Ride, as we talked about in this video. Number two is, on the cooperative side of things, I tend to use things like the mind now.
Yeah.
Which is less overhead of rules.
Yeah.
No.
Just no, one. There's so many like quick, they easy don't, to like, teach.
Yeah, because even when you're teaching Forbidden Island, you yeah. have to, they have to know what to do next. And you kind of have to teach them you and tell them. You kind of have to like do their moves for them for yeah. the first play. Where in some of these newer cooperative games, you don't have to. So I still really enjoy it.
Yeah.
If someone ever said, you want to play Forbidden Island, I'm like, yeah, I love that game.
Yeah.
But I don't bring it out as often in that wow, case.
I was way off, man.
I wouldn't say you're way off. I still love it. I'm going to go back and look. I am surprised now that you say it that it didn't make the
it
list.
It feels somewhere. It's shocking to me that it's not a top 100. But like I said, I thought it would be at least a top 20.
Yeah.
So of course I'm shocked that it's not the 100 at all.
So I only missed three, but 70% is pretty darn good.
Yeah. Yeah. I wanted to get 100, man.
That's a C.
I wanted the A+.
Are you a C student?
I feel like there's some shenanigans with Forbidden Island. I'm just kidding.
I think 7 out of 10 is amazing.
Yeah. Well, and besides Forbidden Island, they were all in your top 100 at least. Yeah. So.
Well, we hope you enjoyed this series.
Yes.
Let us know in the comments if you want to see Greg do his top 100 list, because we're thinking about doing that in the new year.
Yeah.
You
got a lot of end of year wrap up kind of stuff that you need to do.
Yeah, I got to get out a bunch of reviews of stuff that I already know I love that I've played a bunch that I want to get out before the end of the year. But then coming in the new year, we should probably do that. So let us know if you want to see Greg's top 100.
I've put together, it's pretty close to finalized. I might change things a little bit in the coming weeks, but I think it'd be really fun to do that in reverse. And if people are interested, I think I'd love to do it.
Well, there you go. My 101 best games of all time. Thank you, Greg, for putting up with me for
It's been fun.
10
I could sit and talk about games endlessly.
Yes, you can.
That's why these videos are not short.
Yeah. And where can they find you?
I don't do much content besides with you these days, but I love engaging with people on Instagram. So Greg C. Dixon, GREGCDICKSON. And I love it. I post all the time about games. People talk. We talk back and forth. It's great. It's a very friendly environment to talk about games.
There you go.
And to just see what people are playing. So hit me up there and say hi.
On behalf of Greg, we will say good night, everybody. It's been the Game Boy Geek. We'll see you next time. Game Toppers not only transforms your existing table to a high-quality gaming solution, they now offer full leg kits and dining cover solutions for the full table application. Paired with their amazing thematic premium stitch edge mats from noted board game artists like Vincent Dutre, collapsible cup holders, and really cool accessories, it's a complete system that upgrades every game you play. Go to GameToppersLLC.com or click the link below.